we've actually been able to leverage funds from a few different funding sources, and we tapped into CSBG funds. We also received a small grant from the North Carolina Community Foundation. We also had some CARES Act funding. Look, everybody just pitching in where they can to make sure we can put food pantries in these Title I schools, and these schools with, some of the schools have 100% of the students on free and reduced lunch, or 90+% of the students on free and reduced lunch, right? And so the families are struggling, and so we're so proud of the work that we've done. We're actually on Thursday going to be at another ribbon cutting at Grace Creek High School in Cumberland County to open up another food pantry. But this was from this past summer. You can see some of the headlines. We're just so proud of the work we've been able to do to make sure that our young people, they can, they don't have to focus on where their next meal is going to come from. They can focus on their studies. So,
North Carolina is the hungriest, the 10th hungriest state in the nation. One in five children don't know where they're going to get their meal from. So, legalize.
And we just got this success story yesterday. Again, we were figuring out for the past probably 18 months, honestly, trying to figure out how we could get past some regulations, some unallowable calls, how we could bring together some funding to get. So this is a van. The red van that you see is actually is a former van
everybody has a story. I'm in the state, it doesn't mean I'm a bad person.
I will, you know,
I got called a couple bags, and that was it.
I had no code of defense. They tried to give me life, but I didn't get life. I got 360 months.
Community action really is about giving a hand up and not a hand out. People deserve a second chance, and that they should have the support that they need to navigate to be successful.
95% of individuals who are incarcerated are going to be released at some point in time.
We talk to veteran offenders, let them know where we're located, how we cover it from national prison, and the services that we provide.
They offer a good outlook on life.
I'm optimistic.
We're going to be here when we get out. This is what we need for you when we get out.
Everybody deserves a second chance. Everybody deserves a second chance. Everybody needs a second chance.
It takes a village to help a person coming home.
My life's changed.
Totally understand that. And so I just kind of want to tie in with
know what to do with that money. You know, because I can go buy a house and think just because it's the cheapest house on the block that I could save the rest of my $4 million, I can buy this house for $1 million, but then you got taxes. Then you have, I mean, there's so much financial literacy that generations have been deprived of. Hundreds of years of financial literacy that they have not told us about that has kept us back. And here we are now trying to fix it with this program. We need financial literacy.
Objectively, you know, from a researcher,
the super brains over there, how is COVID impact? So we actually did a series of focus groups with low-income participants across the state, and we also did focus groups with organizational leaders that work with low-income communities. And so from all of those, I don't know, hundreds of hours of focus group hours, we have this report, and that's guided our response and how we responded to communities related to COVID. We also did a COVID vaccination campaign. It was called Sleeves Up North Carolina. As you know, vaccination, rates were disproportionate, and people of color were not getting vaccinated. And so I just want to show you a brief clip of one of our, those are our little characters. But here's an example of some of the videos we did.
So I already had COVID-19, so I don't need to get the vaccine.
Come on now. Even if you've been infected with COVID, you still need to get vaccinated. Some people have contracted the virus more than once, and it's not clear how long this infection stays in the body. CDC recommends that a recovered patient get the vaccine 90 days after being infected. Sleeves up, North Carolina. Join me to get vaccinated today.
For free transportation to your vaccine site, call One United NC.
We also partnered with United Way, and they have some free transportation for folks to get to their vaccinations. So just want to show some of the work we've done throughout the pandemic. We also hosted what we call the Big Pop-Up. We got a registered trademark. We were excited to get that R next to our logo here. But essentially, we went all across the state. And in fact, in the past 60 days, we've been to 14 different communities, from Silver, North Carolina, the mountains, to New Bern on the coast, bringing resources to local communities. And I know we're running out of time, but I'm just going to play a minute. And I think you can see really the scope when you have $1 million+ worth of product and thousands of people showing up in their cars, and you're putting product in their cars as they drive through. Of course, the idea was we want to serve people, but we also need to be safe. So we did it outdoors with masks.
We're so excited today to host our first inaugural Big Pop-Up, which is a signature community action agency event. It's designed to help families who are struggling right now in the face of COVID. We know that people have lost their jobs, hours have been cut, kids from home, from school, and that means that the light bill was cost a little bit more, utilities, food costs, and all those things, and impact the people that community action agencies serve. And not just that, but people who never really showed up at a community action agency, so the newly poor. So we just want to give a hand today. That's what community action agencies do. There are 34 agencies across the state of North Carolina, and they pivoted to be able to help families as they struggle to deal with COVID. That's what today's event is about.
So we just want to let them know that as a community.
Now, I'll just pause here. And I said we went to the because I really wish we had time to show you just the sheer number of people who came out. Our event started at 11, 10 or 11. There were cars in the parking lot at 5:30. Water, fresh produce,
Anybody else have any questions of them? I have one question. Since we're here with the Local Human Relations Commission and Local Human Relations Departments and Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Departments, what is it that we as these three entities can do to help the community action, and how is it that y'all can help us out as well? Will you, Christine, or Sharon, you answer that? How can Local Human Relations Commission, Local Human Relations Departments, and Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Departments help you out in certain things, and how can you help us out in certain things?
Well, I think one of the things, too, is that we love
some in the back that they get the handout, if you can, in the back there. They've got some information as to how many community action groups are across the state. I forgot how many, Christine was sharing across the state. 34 community action groups across the state. Give them a hand again, everyone. All right, first presentation has been done. We're going to give you about a 10-minute break. We're going to start at 11 o'clock for the second presentation, which will be coming up shortly. So if you've got a 10-minute break, you want to go use the bathroom, want to get some coffee, you want to eat, whatever. Got 10 minutes? 14 minutes.
Thank you. It don't matter. And it's all it own, though.
Oh, it's Hilton Inn Greenville at the Human Relations Statewide Convention, and been learning a whole lot of information. You know, there were several presentations, but there's something that was saying, you know, a lot of times we're talking about affordable housing, but this is really good to hear what you're here for, which is not so much we do have a housing issue, but we also have an income issue. In other words, when there were statistics the income that we considered to be poverty level. But when you think about it, we had jobs to support the families that would give better income, that would also be an issue in addition to having affordable housing. So that was one thing that stuck out in my mind. For
I learned that there's a state community action group, and I'm not familiar with the one that's in Tarboro, Edgecombe County. When I go back home, I will be seeking this out from the county manager, as well as thrilled to know that 56,000 inmates or ex-offenders have now voted, and I want to be a about all the work you're doing for people that have something on their record or whatever, but they can now vote. And I'm just so thankful for that. Give kudos to Naeem Akbar that actively working out and dealing with the re-entry council. And so going forward, I'm going to see what I can do for you and my community for weatherization, see where there's funding,
Thank you.